second speaker this evening, she's David Kurten. David graduated with a first class BSc in chemistry. What is it with these people in their first class degrees? I mean, it's shocking, isn't it? I wonder why they've become politicians after all that. He then studied to be a teacher and also got a master's degree from Southampton. He spent 15 years in teaching in such exotic places as Botswana, Bosnia, New York, Bermuda, and Croydon. But he survived his 2 years at Royal Russell, so he is here today to speak to us. He was elected to the Great London Assembly as a UKIP member in 2016, and currently sits on the Education, Environment, Fire and Emergency, Housing and Transport Committees at City Hall. He also has recently been selected as the UKIP candidate in the upcoming parliamentary by-election for Lewisham East. It's fair to say that David is a very committed Brexiteer. So without further ado, I give you David Kurten.
Thank you. Introduction, you make me sound so interesting. Well, it was lovely to be here, and back in Croydon, I worked in Croydon a long time ago actually. It was about 2001 to 2003 where I was a chemistry teacher down the road in Royal Russell School. I've been back various times since then, but good to see you here coming out fighting for the cause for Brexit. And I'm sure all of you remember that great night and that great day, 23rd of June 2016. It seems like a long time ago now, doesn't it? We're getting on for 2 years since that day, but it's something I'll never ever forget. And I stayed up all night. I'm sure some of you stayed up all night as well to watch the results come in. It's always wonderful to see the results and come in on the TV screen when they do. But if you remember back to that night, the first result to come in, do you remember what that was? Gibraltar, exactly. Gibraltar came in and it was about 95% to stay in the European Union, because that was the first one. I didn't think to myself, it's only a very small population, it's not going to be representative, and my heart sank. And then Newcastle came in and they voted to stay in the EU as well, and my heart sank a bit more. And a couple more results came in. And then Sunderland came in, and they were 63% to leave, and the pound sank, which I thought wasn't a very good thing, but we all cheered. I've never been so happy to see the pound go down in value as I was then, because it was an indication the markets were responding to the fact that we probably were going to leave. And as the night went on, of course, it became clear, and we left. And the next morning was fantastic. I was very, very lucky to be on Parliament Green, Westminster, outside the House of Parliament. And I was with Nigel Farage and a few other people where he was in front of the cameras. And that was a great day of celebration, of course. But I made a mistake. I think we made a mistake. A lot of people made a mistake to think that we've won the referendum and that was it. We didn't have to do anything more. We thought the people in the Commons, in the Lords and other places would be honourable and without any obstacles in the way at all would just give us a full, clean, easy Brexit, and that was it. And that clearly hasn't been the case. And the next day, of course, Mr. Cameron resigned. There was a leaflet that went out before the referendum saying, whatever you decide, we will implement what you decide. That was that £9 million leaflet that went to every household in the country. Didn't happen with Cameron. But then Theresa May came in and initiated Article 50. So that's on the road. But that's not without one Gina Miller stepping in to try to throw some obstacles in the way. And I actually, it was a few months ago, last year, the end of last year, I actually was in a debate with Gina Miller over in Dublin, in Trinity College Dublin. And she came up and did a speech, and I did a speech very much like we have here. And she said a few things, and I think what she was saying one thing was very interesting was she was going on the road with these people like Chakarumuna and others who wanted to stay in, to listen to people and to try to find out why people wanted to leave the European Union. As though they were, you know, we're really listening to you to understand what we can do to convince you that it's right to stay in. But didn't seem to have any understanding that people wanted to leave because it was the best thing for the country. Didn't seem to understand that at all. So you've got these people who are continually throwing obstacles in the way of the process. And I sit on the London Assembly. And my job on the London Assembly is to question the Mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, at the moment. And he's another one who seems to want to throw obstacles in the way and do all he can to try to convince people that, okay, well, I'm respecting the vote, but we need to stay in the single market, we need to stay in the customs union, we need to stay as close as possible to the European Union, we need to keep on having free movement of people, which is the one of the most important reasons why people voted to leave. Immigration was a very, very big issue. And he commissioned a report from this organisation called Cambridge Econometrics that came out in January. And there's all these kind of reports flying around telling us why it's going to be such a disaster. And the report, however, I read it, and it says, if we stay in the European Union, we're going to be more prosperous. If we come out, we're going to be less prosperous. Everything's going to be a disaster. But it was predicated on the fact that the three assumptions they made in that report were that there will be no change in the exchange rate between the pound and the euro until 2030, which is something you simply cannot predict. It also said there would be no quantitative easing, no more quantitative easing until 2030, which you cannot say with any certainty either. And it also said that European Union workers were more productive than British workers, which I think is quite an insult to the British worker and to the British man and woman who is working. Now, he's not comparing like with like there, because if you take the whole population of the UK, including people who have retired, and you compare that to people who come from the EU who are between 20 and 40 or 50 who are mostly working, yes, you can say that that small group of EU people may be more productive than if you include the whole population, including people who are on welfare and people who are retired, but you're not comparing like with like. So it's quite a disingenuous report, and it harkens back to the things we were told before the referendum, which I often call Project Fear, to try to persuade us and put the fear into us that if we leave, everything's going to be bad. I mean, we were told that every family is going to be £4,500 worse off. Nick Clegg, at one point, before he changed his mind, said there would be 3 million jobs would be lost if we left the EU. He changed that later to saying, well, there's 3 million jobs are connected with the EU that wouldn't necessarily be lost. But he was saying that in the beginning. And I think it was Cameron himself, was saying that the Calais jungle might move to Dover, might move to Kent, which was clearly ridiculous. So these things were said then, they're said again now. And I think one of the biggest thing which came up in the last speech there that we, I think, is another obstacle being put in the way is the Irish border. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't see there's going to be any problem at all with the Irish border. In fact, there was a committee in the European Union that actually wrote a report last year detailing all the possible solutions for the Irish border issue, giving details of technological solutions which could be put in place, comparing the border with other borders that do work around the world, such as the border between Norway and Sweden. Norway is outside of the EU, yes, it's still in the single market, Sweden's inside the EU, but it has a very low friction border. There's the border between the USA and Canada, between Detroit and Windsor. which is a very low friction border where people register before they cross the border by computer if they're moving goods between Canada and the USA, and it works very, very well. So there are cases where there are low friction borders with technological solutions. We have that between the border with Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. It shouldn't be any problem at all. So we just need to get on with it. Now, it's wonderful to be in a gathering like this because we have people from all across the political spectrum wanting to leave the EU because it's the best thing for Britain. And one of the best speeches I ever heard was by a Labour Member of Parliament back in the 1970s when there was the first referendum. You may remember the speech by Peter Shaw he did, saying why we shouldn't vote to stay in the European Economic Community as it was then. And we were taken in on a very false premise, which was quite deceptive, because I was only about one or two at the time, I was a child. But we were told, of course, it's only going to be a trade deal, it's a business arrangement. But even then, Peter Shaw and other people, there were Tony Benn as well, were putting the case that this is going to hurt the ordinary British working person. And that's why we shouldn't go in, because they cared about the ordinary British patriotic working person who does everything right, and they could see that life was going to get tougher and harder if we went into just the European Economic Community at that time. And of course it changed and changed, and now we're on the way to a European superstate. We're in the European Union now, probably the penultimate step. I wouldn't be surprised if there's another treaty soon that turns it into the United States of Europe. But the reasons for coming out are obvious, but I think we need to put the case for coming out with no deal. And the people who are throwing obstacles in the way and trying to convince us to slow down, don't worry, let's have a transition arrangement for another 2 years, maybe that'll turn into another 2 years after that. There is a plan, I think, to keep us in name only, perhaps bring more people from the European Union to immigrate into the country, give out citizenships, which we're doing at a very, very high rate, have another referendum and keep us and get us back into the European Union. So we've got to be aware of what's going on. We've got to be aware of the devices of the people that really want to scupper the process and keep us back in, and get us back in. The reasons for coming out are obvious. £10 billion a year we pay as net to the European Union. And this is a figure that's bandied around. And when you get to thinking about big numbers, sometimes it's hard to imagine what that actually means. But here's what £1 billion actually means. Can you imagine football stadium to Crystal Palace down the road? Imagine it's full, completely full. I don't know how many people capacity in Crystal Palace, 40,000, 50,000 probably, I don't know exactly. But about 40 to 50,000, 25,000. Okay, so imagine 25,000 in Crystal Palace football stadium. Now, if you took all of the wages of all of those 25,000 people for a whole year, that would be less than a billion. Maybe it would be a billion if they all earned £40,000 a year. So it's a year's wages of everybody in a full football stadium. That's what £1 billion is. So when we're talking about a deal to leave the EU for 40 billion, we're talking about 40 full football stadium. Every single football stadium in the Premiership, the Championship, League One, League Two, on a Saturday afternoon in the whole country, and taking a year's salary from every single person in every single football stadium in England and Wales, and giving it to the bureaucrats in Brussels. That's what 40 billion is. That's what it means. That's the amount of money that you're going to take from hard-working British people just to have a deal. That's why I would say we don't need to pay a penny. And if you think about what it is on an ongoing basis, okay, it wouldn't be 40 football stadia, but imagine 10 football stadia full of people taking a year's salary from all of them. That's what we pay to the EU every single year, to pay for bureaucrats in Brussels. That's an immense amount of money earned by hard-working, ordinary people. And we want that money in this country to pay for schools and hospitals and aircraft carriers and police and nurses here, rather than bureaucrats in Brussels. That's one of the main reasons to leave. And of course, in the last speech, Chris touched on imports and exports, and some of you mentioned that as well. And it is actually true that we would be wealthier as a country on the basis of trade. And we mentioned the German car manufacturers and the people that export to the country want a free trade agreement with the UK. There's no reason why we can't have a free trade agreement. It's only to keep the political process going. Because even if you have WTO tariffs, British companies would pay the EU maybe 5-6 billion a year, but EU companies would pay the UK 12 or 13 billion. So we would have a surplus of money coming to the UK, because European companies would be paying more tariffs to us than we would have paid to the EU. So that's more money that can go to spending in education and health in this country. As for regulations, the figure I hear is that 88% of businesses in this country are entirely domestic. So the reason we're coming out is that we can make our own regulations, so that we don't keep the same regulations as the EU. So that the majority of businesses, yes, small and medium-sized businesses that are domestic, can have the regulations they want decided by government in this country for the benefit of businesses in this country. Businesses that do trade with the EU tend to be larger. The large multinational businesses that, you know, trade all around the world are used to dealing with different regulations. So it shouldn't be an excuse that we need to keep exactly the same regulations as the EU, and that if we don't, then that's going to harm trade. Because you've got businesses that trade with America, they trade with Australia, Japan, Russia, African countries, Brazil, the EU. They have different regulations all the time. The big businesses, the global businesses, are used to dealing with regulations, and they can adapt. So the point of leaving the EU is that we can decide our own laws, our own regulations, our own standards. And yes, of course, if you're going to sell something into another country, your products, your services need to adhere to the standards of the country that you're going to sell them into. But businesses that are international are already used to adapting to that and coping with it. So I don't think that is an excuse not to leave and to stick to having exactly the same regulations. If they have good regulations, fine. We can converge. If the regulations the EU has are bad, we can make our own. That's what we need to do. We mentioned fishing, and I know from travelling around the country, fishermen really want back control over our exclusive economic zone, which extends 200 miles off the coast. If you see a map of the exclusive economic zone, it's about three times the area of the land area of the country. It is the richest fishing grounds in the world, or it was before 1970. And I think people say, I've heard it said by people, well, you know, fishing is only a very, very small part of our economy. I don't know why people are so worried about not getting back control of it. Well, I would say, well, if it's only such a small part of our economy, give us back control, because it doesn't mean anything to the EU if it's so small, but obviously it does, because they're very, very rich fishing grounds, but they're our fishing grounds, and our fishermen deserve to have that back. We must not sell them out again. And I want to see our fishermen have back control of our exclusive economic zone on the 29th of March 2019. No more delay for another two years. We need to take back control now. That's what we got to do. And of course, immigration is a big issue. One of the things that I see as a teacher, as an ex-teacher, which isn't very much talked about, is the effect of an unlimited supply of cheap labour from the European Union coming in to this country to do jobs in this country which are low-skilled jobs or unskilled jobs. Now, I don't blame anyone from Poland or Romania for wanting to do that, to do the best for themselves. But it harms our own young people. And it's probably, in some ways by design, but in other ways by benign neglect. If you're a business and you have the choice of employing a 25-year-old from Poland who's already got some skills, or a 16-year-old from the UK who will need a lot of intensive training, who will need care and mentoring, it's cheaper and easier for a business to employ a 25-year-old from Poland with skills. It would just be, they don't need to train them, 25-year-old will have more personal skills. But the effect of this is that we have a young generation that is not getting the skills, training and mentoring they need, not through anyone's real fault, apart from the politicians who have set up the system, just because it's simpler and easier not to train our own young people. And so we have a dearth of skills among young people in this country that's self-perpetuating, because we're not training people, enough people in this country, to be plumbers, electricians, gas fitters, builders, carpenters, joiners, engineers, doctors, nurses, midwives. We have a shortage of all those vital skills. And we're trawling the world, we're trawling the EU and countries outside the EU as well, to fill positions which are vital, and we need people with those skills, because we perpetuated a system where young people are not getting the skills training they need. It's not right that there's more Malawian nurses working in the UK than there are in Malawi. It's not right that there's more Nepalese doctors working in the UK than there are in Nepal. And it's not right that we're not training enough young people to be builders in this country and relying on bringing in builders from the EU and then not training our own young people, because it's easier to trawl the world for skilled workers rather than training and investing in our own young people. And I think this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to turn that round again and get it right. We've been neglecting skills training, we've been neglecting the younger generations and education for far too long. I think we need to have a vision for Brexit so that we use this to become self-sufficient in skills again, so that we can stand on our own two feet. We managed for over 1,000 years. And people say, oh, if we come out of the EU, everything's going to be bad. That's absolute rubbish. We can do it. We just need to remember who we are, what we are, how great we are, and how great we can be again. And this is the perfect time to do it. So we need to take back the initiative. We need to make the case that whatever happens, whether we have the freed trade agreement that would be good with free movement of goods and services and capital, but not the freedom of movement of labour, that would be the ideal. We need to make the case for that, but to say if we don't get that, No deal is better than a bad deal. People used to say that, but they seem to have stopped saying it, hoping that, oh well, people aren't going to notice, time's getting on, we just need to do anything, whether it's bad or not. That's absolutely wrong. No deal is better than a bad deal. And we need to make that case again, because you've got an army of people. That's maybe a good place to end, but that's what we need to do. So thank you very much for this.